It's Tuesday, July 16th, 2019, and isn't today Bastille Day? Oh, that was the 14th, or Freedom Day, or whatever, in France. I don't know why that matters.
It doesn't. And actually, we have a story, two stories, why France is awful.
Yes, why are we not starting with a Jeep Pie?
You know, I thought about that, but I figured Trump is the bigger name, right? Like, that gets more clicks if you start with Trump. Actually, I don't think that would affect it at all. But Trump does deliver clicks. That's been proven. He basically reinvigorated the dying news media. And now he's going to save social media.
We will not let them get away with it. Trump threatens social media ahead of the White House summit. So this article, it's about the social media bias and how, like, the social media, the companies that run social media have a certain agenda, and voices that fall in line with that agenda are okay, but voices that do not fall in line with that agenda, maybe some things happen to those accounts.
Like they get banned.
But it's really, like, there's a deeper issue here because, I mean, look at YouTube lately. They've gone insane. Just, you know, like, capture the flag content and, like, honest to goodness InfoSec content, all of that is just blanket banned. There's a bunch of lawyers on YouTube that, like, make funny videos or videos about lawyery stuff. And even though they're following all the rules, their videos are demonetized or they get strikes. And it's fascinating because it's like, look, there's a lawyer on your platform making, like, honest to goodness, like, editorial and journalistic content. And YouTube's just like, nope, not touching that with a 10-foot pole.
Well, it's obvious. YouTube doesn't want anything that any advertiser could possibly get any backlash for. And in this day and age, that's a tiny, tiny percentile of any kind of content because everybody's offended by something, right?
So the only solution is to do what Spotify is doing and basically kick everybody off and only deal with middlemen who vet people.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's going to destroy your platform. Now, what Trump did was neither of those things. What Trump did was he rounded up all the pro-Trump people who had been silenced or banned and invited them to the White House. And he didn't invite any of the heads of the social media companies or any of the other point of view. I don't know what was accomplished with this.
Nothing. It would be like the world's largest echo chamber.
But he didn't. The interesting thing that he mentioned here was that if the social media companies didn't get their act together and stop silencing conservatives, then in 6 years, they're going to have a huge problem, which I think alludes to maybe Trump throwing his resources behind some kind of social media thing when he gets out of the office.
That would probably be hilarious.
Well, 6 years from now, do you think any of the social media platforms are still going?
No.
Maybe.
I think the TikTok will have taken over the world and nothing will be relevant anymore.
Aren't they doing poorly?
No, they're doing amazing. One of our stories talked about how amazing they were doing.
So, yeah. Oh.
Oh, the ad. The ad has taken over.
No, is that?
Yeah, it pushed the page down.
No, but which button is the topic change?
Oh, one.
That's what did that.
That's weird.
Okay. I've completely lost track of what I was saying. Oh, yeah, Donald Trump. We got another story about him. So, I think someone sat him down and gave him a very, very top-level brief overview of cryptocurrency, and he's against it.
He has blasted Facebook's Libra and demands strict regulation. Unregulated crypto assets can facilitate unlawful behavior, Trump warns. And it's like, nobody tell him about Bitcoin.
Well, he did mention Bitcoin. And he's also against that.
Yeah.
He does not like the cryptocurrencies. Of course, you know, he's a big pro-dollar guy. He wants the dollar to be stronger. Trade wars and so forth.
A lot of trade, little bit more on the trade war side, a little bit less on the dollar side, but okay.
Yeah. But someone who maybe knows a little bit more about how money works. Oh, Trump, his one of his great comments was, it's like, it's backed by nothing. Do you think he understands fractional reserve lending?
No. I mean, there is not a chance he understands.
He went to Wharton, right?
Yeah.
Do you think that they have to cover that at some point, right?
No, it's been so long ago. And it's like, it's, you know, golf binge fueled haze.
We were on fractional reserve lending in, well, the '70s. Is that when he went to school? Or?
Yeah. So I mean, no.
So he has anyway. No, oh, that's going to be a problem. I'm going to have to start clicking back over to the Someone who might know a little bit more about it has also expressed concerns about Libra.
The Fed chief calls for Facebook to halt the Libra project until concerns can be addressed. Mainly, he's worried about money laundering. And it's like, wait, won't this facilitate money laundering? I don't think anybody should tell the Fed chief about the money laundering that's going on Amazon.
I don't think he's mainly worried about money laundering. I think he's mainly worried about the Gresham's Law.
Bad money forces out good.
Because people are going to, you know, it's capital controls. Now, the U.S. doesn't really worry about capital controls because we're throwing our money all over the globe, and that's good for us.
Pallets and pallets of cash have gone missing in Iraq.
But, yeah, and more importantly, taxation. Although I'm sure that Libra is going to report you all day long.
Yeah.
Right,
I mean, it's a there's no anonymity with Libra because Facebook is involved, one, but two, cryptocurrency. You combine those two forces and there's no anonymity.
So we didn't start with the Jeep Pie, but that doesn't mean we don't have a Jeep Pie content. Those of you who were worried, we do have it. Now, remember, I guess it's been 2 weeks ago, we talked about that law about apartment buildings and the wiring inside of them.
Things have gotten weird.
And it's like, okay, well, that kind of makes sense. Well, a Jeep Pie has stormed in, but he stormed in on a platform that makes absolutely no sense. I mean, it's ridiculous.
This is crazy, in quotation marks. The FCC has killed part of San Francisco's broadband competition law. So Ars Technica tried to unpack this. I don't know that they succeeded.
I had to read it twice.
Yeah. So a Jeep Pie is literally trying to say that for an apartment building, if a customer is subscribed to one ISP and they elect to subscribe to a second ISP, he just wants to be clear that those two ISPs don't have to share the same Ethernet cable running to a particular apartment in an office building. The San Francisco law was more like multiple ISPs can install their equipment independently in a single apartment building, and as long as the wiring is unused, any particular ISP can use whatever wiring is in an office building. So there's a distinction between the wiring that comes to the building and then the wiring that is distributed throughout the building from, say, a wiring closet or a series of wiring closets through a multi-story building.
I think the goal here, though, is just to strike it down on this insane ground.
Yeah.
So, and the people of San Francisco were like, well, I think you misinterpreted because that's sort of an impossible scenario, and we're not trying to say anything about that. This is for inactive units only. But I don't know if he's trying to hear that or not. You know?
No. Well, part of his original argument was that building owners should be able to be paid. And like, it was a totally normal thing that you would see. This is how New York City got in a bad situation with this kind of stuff. But say you own an apartment building, you can contractually set up a deal with Time Warner or somebody at the time, Time Warner, Comcast, whoever. And it's like, I will give you access to all of the tenants in my building in exchange for you wiring it and providing service. And the building owner would get a pretty substantial amount of money, and, you know, Comcast or whoever would have a captive audience for the people in that apartment building. And originally, Ajit Pai was saying that those kind of deals need to be protected because there's not a lot of incentive for those ISPs to give a landlord money if the tenants can still order service through another provider. But this isn't that at all.
He would like it to be.
Yeah. It's sort of nuts.
Once in a while, though, even Ajit Pai does something right. And when he does something right, he likes to break it down into little bitty parts so he can press release each individual part so you think maybe he's doing something right. And this one is just a slam dunk. Even Hitler would have supported this. Like, there's been no despot in history that wouldn't have taken this slam dunk.
Robocall ban should target texts and foreign calls, the FCC chief says. So the proposed new rules would extend robocall blocking to international calls and texts. They cite there's a couple of companies or a handful of companies that they've already taken down that are doing like auto insurance renewals, and like there's an old folks scam and like two or three other things. And it's like, yes, this has already been successful in the private sector. We need to do more to do this. Okay.
I think we should enter into a world where anything agreed to over the phone is not enforceable. It's not a valid contract.
Yeah.
Because there's no reason for that anymore.
There have been cases that were really egregious where people have recorded their calls and the robocallers have gotten them to say yes, and then like the robocallers have spliced together somebody saying yes into agreeing to a whole bunch, and it's like, no, that's not what you asked me. You asked me something else. It's crazy.
Well, we have the scourge of ransomware as I frantically scroll back to the top of the story. Because
do you have numlock on? Because numlock should not be on.
I can't tell, but we'll click it. Ransomware. Florida got hit twice. I think,
we made fun of Florida for 3 weeks in a row because it was just endless.
Philadelphia, right?
Philadelphia.
Alabama. Maybe it was North Carolina, one of them.
It turns out that all these little municipal cities should not have computers. They should go back to typewriters.
Well, they had to for a little while. So the thing about those stories, the thing they have in common other than ransomware, is almost everybody paid. I think Philadelphia didn't, right?
I think they all ended up paying.
Did they?
One of the I don't know if it was Philadelphia, but one of the cities that paid the ransomware brought in some tech specialists to help them recover their stuff, and so they paid the tech specialists who then paid the ransomware.
Yeah, they say that those those protection companies, those insurance companies, they always pay.
Yeah.
That's how it works. They don't fix it, they just pay. Anyway, that's probably bad because even though you're saving yourself, you're kind of screwing everybody down the line. It's like pulling out slowly from a red light. you don't notice it because it's just normal for you, but everybody behind you hates you because you're slow. And that is what this group of mayors seeks to fix.
A U.S. mayor's group adopts a resolution not to pay any more ransoms to hackers. What's actually going to happen is they're going to continue to pay ransoms to hackers because they do not have backups.
The other thing that's interesting about this, non-binding, because I don't think, even if you're a member of the U.S. mayor's group or whatever this is, you don't have to follow their rules. They're not like a powerful entity or anything.
This is like, I guess this is a message to ransomware attackers to be like, please don't attack us. We're not going to pay. But they'll pay.
They will. They'll pay. You know, they said that Philadelphia, for holding out, was losing millions a day.
Yeah.
And I don't know what the total price was, but after 3 or 4 days, you're already better off having paid it right away.
I've had to have that conversation with people a few times. It's like, look, you're saving $500,000 by not doing this thing that you need to do, but annually it costs you like $2 million. Are you dumb? Can you not do the math? And then it's like, oh yeah, we should probably do that. Ransomware, same kind of thing. Although if they don't fix the problem, the ransomware people will just come right back later, and it makes them a juicy target. It's like, ah, this person's willing to pay the ransom. Then the whole criminal underworld gets a memo with your name on it, and then that's very bad.
But there is no fixing the problem, because the problem is the ineptitude of government workers. You know, they just get fished. So what are you going to do about that? Shoot the people if they click a link?
If that's the level of fear that they need in order to not click those links?
Voting machines. We talk about voting machines constantly because they are not super secure. And in fact, you know, we're coming up on the end of life of Windows 7. And other than those hardcore anti-telemetry people, who's using Windows 7, you ask? Enterprises? Well, maybe. You know, people with software that isn't ported to the new ones? Maybe. But sadly and shockingly, guess who else?
This AP exclusive is new election systems use vulnerable software. So these are new, quote unquote, election machines ready for a new election cycle. Guess what? They're on Windows 7.
Yeah. Sad. And here's the thing about election machines. Like they're really important, right? Why not just run your own OS? Because your OS doesn't have to do a lot of things. It has to count things.
There are actually PhD students that have produced mathematically verifiably secure operating systems just for such a purpose.
And yet, not interested. Now, you might be thinking to yourself, okay, got my torch, got my pitchfork. Whose house do I need to go to get on the situation with this Windows 7 voting machine? Who do we need to attack? Who needs to be brought down to fix this problem? Well, sir, that's a trade secret.
Techter has this article. The voting machine makers claim the names of the entities that own them are trade secrets. Yes, the North Carolina State Board of Elections asked the suppliers of electronic voting machines a simple question. Who owns you? And they get a bunch of non-answers. Now, you might be thinking other things too, like, maybe it's like Windows 7 embedded and there's an extended support contract for that, or, you know, a whole bunch of other things. No, security researchers like DEF CON and Black Hat will be more than happy to tell you that these systems are wildly insecure and not patched.
And again, what percentage of Windows 7's suite of features do you need for a voting machine? One. The mouse.
Touchscreen support.
The display.
Remember those reports from last year where the touchscreens were so badly calibrated that you would touch the screen and it would vote?
Was that, you know, was that really a mistake, though? So, yeah, that's a sad state that we're in. What was it? Was it Sweden or Switzerland? They were letting their post office design voting machines.
Oh, yeah. And they had the software online, and then it leaked ahead, and it was wildly insecure.
Yeah.
Oops.
So, this is a case of private companies who are probably in bed with politicians.
9 out of 10 computer scientists agree. Voting machines, no.
Then when you let do you let the government do it, or do you let the corrupt private companies do it? I don't Both answers are wrong.
And you ask the computer scientists, the academics, and they're like, what are you doing making a voting machine like this? This is crazy.
I just had to get my driver's license renewed because of change of address, which I had resisted for quite some time. But turns out they won't sell you a gun if that doesn't match. And it's just shocking how badly the DMV is run pretty much everywhere. I mean, it's a meme that everybody hates it, right? But when you think to yourself, when it's over, I don't have to deal with that for ever how many years, and, you know, nothing bad is going to happen now, right? But wait, the DMV has an extra message for you.
The Florida DMV sells your personal information to private companies and marketing firms. They make about $77 million a year. This is a WPTV article. Like, this should be national news, but it turns out, so there was this old lady, I guess, that was in a nursing home or something.
I don't know if it was an old lady, but it was somebody with some kind of disease who never left the house, but they needed an ID to do something.
Like their Medicare or Medicaid or some kind of financial assistance.
So this is a person who doesn't shop, doesn't have credit cards, doesn't have a banking account, doesn't have any marketing.
Any digital footprint.
They don't exist as far as the online stuff, except they eventually had to get that driver's license.
And guess what? They turned up in a database, and then an investigation happened, and then it's like, wait, the DMV literally sells this. That seems bad.
Yeah, so they said, the DMV says, well, yeah, we do sell data, but they're not allowed to use it for marketing purposes.
The investigators here also figured out that they could also get individually identifiable information out, which was not supposed to happen, but any list of data like this, there's personally identifiable information in it, and it's out. I mean, it's out. What more do you want?
And if Facebook is not allowed to profit from selling my data, should the government be?
This is all public information. Is it, though? Is it really?
Well, it technically is, because, yeah. We do business with a company that counts on that. But let's make it not. How about that? Oh, this might be the feel-good story of the week. We should refresh this, and we've talked about this several times, but simplest form possible, a law firm made porn, made it themselves, put it on the torrent sites.
Like the Pirate Bay.
And then every IP that connected to it and downloaded it, well, they copyrighted it first, obviously. Then every IP that connected to it and downloaded it, they sued.
So it turns out that's frowned upon, using the judicial system to shake people down like that. And so the cooperative copyright troll lawyer has been sentenced to 5 years in prison. His co-conspirator got 15 years in prison, who is appealing his sentence. This is Prenda Law, the whole, Prenda Law story finally comes to an end, pretty much. Although I'll be upset if the guy that got 15 years like gets through his appeal and gets less than 5 years, because the one guy is just, one of the lawyers is like, oh, this is wrong, I shouldn't have done this, and the other lawyer is just shamelessly.
Yeah, well, I don't think either of them should get any leniency. I mean,
well, the one got 5 years, which is kind of leniency.
How could you not know what you were doing was the lowest of the low? And you're supposed to,
lawyer,
as an officer of the court, Don't you take some kind of
lawyer
or something?
Lawyer.
So yeah, you should get no money. 5 years is far too little. But it was a crazy scam, and I think it only worked because people were embarrassed because porn.
Yeah.
So at least maybe nobody will copy it. I remember a few years ago we did a story about a ringtone that only kids were able to hear. Remember that?
Oh yeah, yeah.
So governments, they saw that. I saw that idea and they said, how can we make this the most evil thing we can think of?
I've seen a few cases of this, though, but even before that, it's like, can you hear it? Sonic devices play high-pitched noises to repel teens. So in places where teenagers hang out, they just have this really high-pitched noise. And so, you know, teenagers can hear it, and so they don't hang out because it's annoying.
One girl described it as, it's like a buzzing in the back of your head. Like, you don't really hear it, but it's there. Also, I think it's just at night.
Mm.
So they don't, you know, the kids are vandalizing and spray painting and doing stuff like that.
Stabbing.
But as much as I dislike children and teens, and as much as I would love them to just be caged in their homes and not have to deal with them, reference that trip to the DMV. One guy had two strollers. Oh my God. Anyway, even though I can't stand them, I cannot support putting up devices to run them away like dogs in public places. They do have rights. The one politician is aggressively trying to get these taken down. And
yeah, this is an NPR story. It's kind of interesting.
Although, did you see those videos this week of, I think that was in Philadelphia, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Philadelphia teens who will just flash mob like convenience stores and just tear them apart.
No, I didn't.
Oh, you gotta watch those videos. Yeah, it's just insane.
That's terrible.
It's like a plague of locusts hitting a CSP or a CVS. The British Airways had a little data breach. Well, they didn't really have a data breach. They had somebody got into their systems and redirected their traffic.
Mm.
So it wasn't their data, but it was their security failure. Now, in the past, you probably think, well, that's probably going to be like a $10 million fine, right? But now with GDPR, they are not playing around anymore.
British Airways is facing a record £183 million fine for data breach. Everybody's airline ticket is going up 10 pounds for the next 15 years in order to cover this.
Hey, you don't get any snacks anymore. They got a nice little infographic down here to show. So, like, let's look at, all right, we got Sony here, and he's like, okay, you have Scottish Border Council, and I think Equifax. Oh, yeah, here we go, Equifax. There's Equifax and Facebook. Pretty big circles, right? Boom. British Airways. So, yeah, GDPR, these Euro governments are not playing around with these companies. They want the money, and now they have the means to take it.
Seems like it would be of more value to the company to just not maintain that data.
That's a good question. I mean, I don't think you make $183 million a year. Certainly. Selling data, right?
Yeah, I mean, how many customers can British Airways have?
Although, if Florida DMV can make $77 million, was it 77 or 17?
It was 77.
If they can make that from one DMV, British Airways probably makes more than that. Because they have a lot more people flying than you have getting licenses at one place, right?
I wonder if it's going to turn into a vicious cycle where now British Airways is compelled to sell your data in order to make up the money from the fine. So they're going to put all kinds of clauses and stuff in there. It's like, you agreed to this. You agreed.
Yeah, the robocalls go up, you know, by order of magnitude because they keep getting more fines. It's a vicious circle. France. Oh, no. Yahoo does that thing where it automatically puts the cursor in the search bar. France, now as we alluded to earlier, France, a terrible place. And pretty universally hated, I think. A lot of people look down on the French. And I'm sure nobody will disagree with that in the comments. But we welcome the engagement. Anyway, they've done something else that I don't think is going to move them up the list on loved governments at all.
France is pushing a new law that would jail social media officials for not deleting hate speech. And this Yahoo News article goes on to explain why that is a terrible idea and why the government deciding what exactly is hate speech is going to end very badly.
Now, they do have... yeah, here we go. Sexual orientation, religion, nationality, race, gender identity or disability, harassment, and propaganda tied to terrorism or war crimes. Basically everything. Did you see the video about the guy at the bagel shop?
Oh yeah, where he goes crazy because there's girls behind the counter trying to do stuff.
Yeah, because he's short. Yeah, like he's a tiny little guy. And you know, I was talking to somebody about that. I was like, this guy is so unlucky because as a minuscule white male, he is the one demographic that it's okay to hate and make fun of anymore. And so like the entirety of the internet just zeroed in on him for destruction, and he's not a protected class. So what's he going to do about it? He's not in that list.
He needs to dye his hair pink and
transition.
Speak with a lisp or something.
That's all he can do. And France is not done yet. Although, I mean, I don't know. This one's not as despotic, I think. This is just, once again, there's that
big, cash grab.
Big delicious pie, and everybody wants their part.
France approves a digital tax on American tech giants, defining the U.S. trade threat. So it's 3%, and it is so poorly defined as to basically be undefined. It's like, I don't know, 3%. It's like 3% of what? 3% of gross revenue? 3% of revenues from France? 3% of profit?
Yes.
Yeah, and it's just, okay. All those things.
Which, you know, in terms of Facebook, 3% is, they make what, $5 billion a quarter?
Yeah.
So, those are big numbers. Not bad. Now, Trump has weighed in on this, and Trump says that that's trade war talk. And you might get some tariffs. He loves those tariffs, you know. So we'll see. I mean, it is true that almost every company that law would target is a U.S.-based company.
I think Google could probably turn off Google search in France and be fine.
Or Facebook, Twitter.
Just shut
them down.
Make the people pay it. The people that are in it. It's like, if you want to use Facebook, you're going to have to pay this.
And we know that Google has that technology because of China. So
we laugh, but it actually would be better for competition and diversity on the internet. It would be less homogenous.
If that would be better for France, even.
Yeah.
Because if they had to bootstrap and create their own search engine, then all of a sudden we had two.
Yeah. Their Ministry of Culture having a French language search engine that's actually not garbage. That could be.
I don't know, with the work ethic over there. I mean, each search is going to take 30 minutes. Are you ready for that?
A little old lady that's retired would have to, like, go to a card catalog. And
remember when Japan landed on the asteroid and then they shot it and then they blew it up? Well, that was all successful, and now they've come back.
Japan's Hayabusa 2 probe has collected samples from a distant asteroid. So they describe a fridge-sized thing landing on this thing, collecting what were probably organic samples and maybe water, and now they're going to try to get this thing back to Earth.
This was the crater that was left from the explosion. So they blew away. They got a sample from the outer crust, which had been, you know, irradiated. Then they blew it up, landed in the crater, and got the juicy insides.
So we're going to learn about the solar system. I think it said that this particular comet or asteroid or whatever was 4.5 billion years old. So it's probably going to reveal a lot about the early composition of the solar system. And there could even be organic matter here.
It could be a protovirus that wipes us all out.
This is literally the Andromeda strain come to kill us all.
We will have learned a lot from that. Like, shouldn't have done that.
An empty Earth with our nascent AIs, just like, I don't know, where'd everybody go?
She's just on a loop, broadcasting out into the nothingness.
Yeah.
Don't mess with asteroids. Asteroids, not even once. The Chinese, of course, are constantly accused of stealing our trade secrets. And I think that's unfair, right? I mean, there's no proof of that.
Oh, no. The U.S. has charged Chinese software engineer Xudong Yao with stealing trade secrets from a former American employer. The suspect, known as William Yao, is considered a fugitive and believed to be back in China, the U.S. prosecutors say. He faces 9 counts of theft of electronic files and worked for a locomotive manufacturer in Illinois.
This was train routing software. So, like, you got a bunch of train tracks, you got a bunch of trains. Obviously, keeping them from running into each other.
That sounds like a version of the traveling salesperson problem. That's going to be hard.
Yeah, that's valuable stuff, right? And we know that China loves building big, fast trains. So, just grab that.
Let's get some software.
But, you know, I'm maybe we're stealing stuff from them. Do you think we'd hear about that in the news if that happened?
Oh, yeah. No, there was definitely a case where it was with the windmills and some poor German company, I think. That's a story for another day.
Oh, yeah, I think I remember that. Yeah, but that wasn't so much espionage as just like bureaucratic
rape. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's a different way of going about it.
We laugh, but it's actually horrifying.
Over in China, they're also having a little problem with Hong Kong. And the people of Hong Kong, it was because of that extradition law. It was going to make it so that mainland China could just come in and grab you out of Hong Kong and prosecute you in China. People were a little afraid of that. I don't know why. But they have been in the streets ever since. I mean, it's crazy. Because you think about how many people are over there. They can stir up like a 1 or 2 million march in no time at all. And it's happening like just day after day. So you can't get that into China through the firewall. What do you do?
Hong Kong's protesters put AirDrop to ingenious use against the data China's firewall. So AirDrop is a... This article talks about how AirDrops were used in like World War II. Haha. But they're talking about AirDrop, the iPhone functionality, which is a peer-to-peer file sharing system. And so there's no blocking that because it's not really on the internet. If you were in Hong Kong, internet access in Hong Kong was basically terrible during all of these protests. But with AirDrop, they could share files, and it was basically fine. In one case, they were sharing something that looks like it was a money transfer thing, but then when you would look at it, it was like, hey, this is the law they're trying to pass. This is all the stuff that it does. This is why it's bad.
Do you ever see that? They had a thing for North Korea. There was a group. I think it wasn't a government group. It was like a nonprofit or something. And they would get balloons and AirDrop, like, portable DVD players and box sets of Western TV shows. It's like, no, look at how the world really can be, was basically the idea. It's like, here's season 3 of Friends. You know? Well, that's not really how the world is, but if you're North Korean, imagine how that blows your mind. You know, you're watching that in the cellar so the stormtroopers don't see it.
I'm imagining the movie The Gods Must Be Crazy, and the DVDs are like the Coke bottle.
Although, I don't think they would have the means to recharge those.
Yeah, it's like, oh, the magic box has run out of power. No.
There's no way you're going to get through a whole season of Friends.
Sorry.
We don't often talk about Brazil in the tech news. They don't make the tech news very often. And this one, the headline seems really great. And it seems like, hey, maybe everybody should have this. But when you read into it, it gets a little darker.
Brazil to add digital data protection to fundamental rights. A proposal has been approved to put protection of personal information on digital platforms to the individual guaranteed by the Constitution. The only problem is that you have to give that data that's protected over to the government.
And the bigger problem is the spark that lit this fire was a corrupt politician
misusing
got
data.
His data stolen, and it exposed his corruption. So he was like, no, we can't have this. This is bad.
What you should do is just treat it as fake news. Just call everything fake news, and then it'll be fine.
Well, that's basically what he did. He played the old this is not true, and I was the victim here card.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is, that's how you do that. It usually works. Now, we've heard about India plans to go to the moon. I think Japan has a moon program. Does China have a moon program?
Probably.
All the big, you know, space agencies seem to have a moon program. And now, another one has joined. Another one bites the moon dust.
That might be this week's title. TASS, I think, has the least credible story this week. But it says, Russia plans to use 3D printing and lunar dust to create a moon base. According to Roscosmos, or they're going to call it Roscosmos, I guess. I don't know. So, moon dust is insanely abrasive. I'm not sure that it's a good building material.
But abrasive is what you want for, like, concrete.
Yeah, because it's going to lock together.
Yeah, because, like, desert sand can't be concrete. It has to be river sand. And we have a global river sand shortage.
Yeah.
So, that might work. It makes sense because you wouldn't want to carry all that mass to the moon.
Yeah.
But how much moon dust do we have on the Earth to test with?
Not a lot.
Yeah, it's... You really...
So we're going to have to send robots. We're going to have to send Terminators, basically, to the moon to build this thing and then be like, yep, it works, or doesn't.
Well, the big test, I think, though, that you're not going to be able to do is the long-term viability of it.
Yeah.
So, I mean...
Lava tubes. Just drill a hole in a lava
tube.
How
do you simulate something coming out of space and hitting it?
Oh, yeah. That would... yeah, lava tubes, again, would probably be better.
Can you 3D print a lava tube? I don't know.
No, they're already there. You just drill a hole in the top of it and you're good to go. It's also built-in radiation shielding, which is awesome.
What about the moonworms?
Well, that might be a problem. We'll need some mood radex.
Moving on to security. passwords for a lot of people are a huge issue. You get a lot of support calls and it's like, hey, my email isn't working. And you say, okay, what's your password?
Hunter 2.
I don't know. I don't know my password. I got a new iPhone. I don't know my password. And, well, like you say, yeah, bad passwords. Terrible passwords. And it's so bad that the people at Microsoft have kind of just thrown up their hands.
Microsoft is making Windows 10 passwordless. It's part of a bigger push to get rid of passwords. So this sounds like this would be a terrible idea, but it's actually making the password... device specific, or the passcode, or the fingerprint, or whatever. So, like with Windows Hello, it's not just you're logging in with your face, there's also a token on the device. So, you have to have that specific device. Your face login somewhere else is not going to work. And, you know, your face, or your fingerprint, or whatever, or your PIN number, whatever it is that gets you in. And that's actually more secure than having to type your password every single day, because you could get a keylogger, or you could get something that asks you for your password. And it's like, if you only ask for your password when you're enrolling new devices, something like this could actually be more secure. Combine this with two-factor, and it's actually a pretty secure setup.
And they talk about that's all going to take place in the TPM, and so the main operating system should never see any kind of password. Although we have seen security problems with that as well.
So. Or token, or PIN number, or whatever.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the TPM itself has been kind of cracked open recently. So.
Yeah. Thanks, Intel.
Now, we alluded to Windows 7 earlier, and that maybe there could be some security risks with it. But what if those security risks come from inside the house?
Microsoft has stirred suspicion by adding telemetry to a security-only update. So this is not the first time. A lot of people are like, hey, I'm selling Windows 7, not Windows 10. It's not spying on me. Bad news. A lot of the Windows 10 telemetry has been backported and patched into Windows 7 for quite some time. This is really upsetting to a lot of firms because this is a security update, a security-only update, which some firms are enrolled in. And it sure does look like this security-only update is adding logging telemetry for remote monitoring. So,
well, when they dug into it, it's bad, but it's kind of like I think Microsoft officially had no comment, but behind the scenes, the answer is really it's like, no, we didn't add telemetry. This is a security-only update. We were updating the security on that telemetry that we added the last time we did that. It needs a security update. So technically, this is a security update. So you shouldn't be angry about it.
Come over to the Linux land. The water's fine, basically.
If you are using an Android device and you use popular apps, you might think, well, there's no way that Facebook could spy on me. Well, maybe Facebook's spying on me, but it's not installing malware, right? It's Facebook. I can trust it.
Facebook is so secure and so worried about people spying on me, I've got a free VPN service through Facebook.
But if you are using a super popular app like Facebook or Twitter or something like that, you might have to worry about Agent Smith.
Malicious apps infect 25 million Android devices with the Agent Smith malware. So this is a malware for Android that has, as so far, gone undetected. This is another data point in that Google is literally not paying attention at all to what is going on in the Android App Store, because I feel there's no way that if they had just one person that was looking at Android Store uploads, just one person, they would have caught this.
You think one person could cover all of them?
Yeah, I mean, just looking at the analytics and looking at the data, it's like one person would take like the top 100 applications and just look at them. They would have caught this.
So this thing will actually, you know, disguise itself as an install of one of those popular apps. It will install the app. I know the app will function normally, but it will then hijack the permissions you give to that app, which in the case of Facebook,
it was everything.
Literally everything your phone can do, and it will install other payloads. So far, they've only seen it serving ads, but with the Facebook permissions, it can do whatever it wants.
It seemed like I read another article that said that not just serving ads, but also it was a low grade, like click farm kind of a thing. So generating, I guess, bot traffic for ads, because that's a great way to rip off advertising companies.
And that could like directly cost you money through your data cap.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's not great. But, you know, hey, that's not really the fault of Facebook or Google or any of the big guys, right? That's just people using their names in vain. And we shouldn't blame them for it. They would never, ever betray our trust like that.
Oh, wait. TNW has Google contractors are secretly listening to your assistant recordings. So what? There's an interesting thing that happened, and there's like three different articles here on this.
I actually cut them all down to this one.
Oh, okay. It's just the...
Because they're all the same.
The first place to cover this was out of Belgium. What does that tell you about how crazy this is?
Well, that's where it happened.
So that's crazy.
So what happened is there was a leak, and it seemed like it was a malicious leak.
Yeah.
Like somebody was like, people need to understand what's happening here, because this is a person who was hired to listen to your Google recordings. And that we've talked about this before, I think with Alexa, right? Where they're just warehouses full of people listening and being like, trying to teach the AI how to understand you better. But in doing so, humans are listening to your stuff. So this person said, the world needs to know, they released it, and then Google was forced to admit it.
Yeah, well, Google actually freaked out. They said that they had launched an internal investigation. The security, like, I think this is an exact quote, the security team has been mobilized. And so I get the picture of, like, people in, like, full riot gear in helicopters departing from Mountain View or Santa Clara or somewhere and, like, flying via helicopter
There's an empty rack of M4s in the Google headquarters somewhere.
They're going to deal with those contractors in Belgium.
Now, the other thing, the local TV station you talked about, the people that broke this, they were able to tie those recordings to real people.
Yeah, and you're not supposed to be able to do that. It's supposed to be anonymized. Mm. Oops.
Sad. Something tells me that there's going to be a GDPR ruling coming out.
Oh, man, that's going to be like a lot of money.
But it also confirms what everybody has really already known. Yeah. That yes, it's recording. It's recording more often. Now, I think these were just okay Google recordings. But I don't believe that. That's probably what they're letting the warehouse people listen to. But I don't believe that's all they record.
You think any of our okay Google shenanigans have come up in the recordings? Because it's like, okay, Google, order some gummy bears.
Well, I mean, if we hit, you know, like, say 100 people per video when we do that, then yeah. Although I don't know about... In Belgium, it's probably just Belgium language, right?
Yeah. So I think it's Alexa that can order the gummy bears anywhere.
We got to figure out a different language to do a, you know, home bot attack on every week. In Greece, they've had another hacking issue. But this one is interesting because this hacking team, they said to themselves, you know, going after individuals and breaking into individual systems, that's hard. What if we could just break into the main pipeline and once we're there, do whatever we want? That seems easier.
ZDNet has, hackers have breached Greece's top-level domain registrar. So this is a lot like hackers getting a hold of .com, like anything .com. But this is Greece's top-level domain.
It's .gr. GR and something else. I can't remember what the other one was. But they have two. EL. .gr and .el. So once they got in there, what they could do is they could take popular .gr and .el sites, route them to their man-in-the-middle sites, and just harvest away.
Mine cryptocurrency, steal passwords, all kinds of fun stuff. This is bad.
Yeah. So unfortunately, Greece is in the European Union, but as we know, GDPR cannot be used against your government. Sad. You know, the thing about that, the record fine, British Airways, at the footnote in that article, is like, okay, so what happens to all that money? And it's like, how much goes to the victims? Zero. Nothing. It all goes to the agencies who fine the companies. And some of it goes into the treasury. So it just fuels the
So what you're saying, parasites. The people in Belgium that had the recording stolen and they're now forever part of the indelible, you know, news story of forever, they get no compensation?
Nothing. They get nothing. They might be able to sue individually. I don't know what the Belgian court system is like.
That would be funny.
But that would probably be like dismissed or rolled into the national one.
Everybody wants their cut all the way down.
Yeah, but the only people who get the cut are the agencies who are fining the tech companies.
Seems like that's mafia. Like, that kind of reminds me of protection money.
Now, let's say that you are a Chinese hacker, and you work for a company that's... they got some really, really sensitive data, and you have kind of a low-level position, but you need to get into those air-gap systems. Now, you've infected them, but now you have to exfiltrate the data. How will you do that? The answer is here.
Academics are stealing data from air gap systems via keyboard LEDs. So software can control your caps lock and your num lock and your scroll lock light. So software can toggle that on and off subtly and surreptitiously. And you can use that to transmit information from a system that has been compromised.
Very slowly.
Yes.
They actually have some data rates here. It's not fast. But if you had a security camera that was running 24/7... over time, you could probably do some damage with this.
You could definitely steal, like, private encryption keys and stuff like that easily. The most sophisticated attack like this that I saw used the Ethernet LEDs, and those will blink at a very high rate.
It's tough to get a camera. I mean, unless the computer's sitting on a desk, though, with the back facing something. If they're, like, in a server stack or something.
They used a high-speed camera and just stuck it somewhere and then came to get it a few months later. It was just like the optics were such that it was just right in on the network connection, and it's like, oh, that's weird.
We're gonna see like super secure keyboards with no lights on them.
Or just take some electrical tape and just put over your LEDs.
Well, they could just yank that off, though.
I think the ST211, the old 5.25-inch drive, I think that if you had a high speed camera, you could actually read the data that the hard drive was reading from the platters via the LED.
Probably not too many of those in use.
No, well, 10, I mean, you never know. It might be. It's from the 80s, so there might still be one of those in use somewhere.
I think that's the last story. So hard to tell with this new Chromium theme.
What do we got? What do we got coming up tomorrow?
This was government security. Tomorrow will be business and social.
Neat. We'll see you tomorrow.
Not a lot of social media in this one, but it was all government fine related, so I figured we'd put it in government.
Yeah, there's not really a lot of news this week, really. I mean, there's a podcast on Patreon now. We're uploading these as MP3s to Patreon because Google is getting weird about downloading as MP3s from YouTube.
Which we'll have a story about in the business section. Stay tuned.